Amen. Well, good morning, my friends, those of you in the room, and we still have folks who are watching us online. It is so good to gather, and just like last week, we celebrate that Christ is risen. He's risen indeed, for he is the same yesterday, today, and forever. We're going to sing songs of worship to our King and celebrate that indeed he does reign. Will you join me in standing as we do so? And let's lift our hearts and our voices in songs of praise. And we invite you this morning to lift your hearts in song to the King.
Of the risen King, who delight to bring him praise. Come all and tune your hearts to sing to the morning star of grace. From the shifting shadows of the earth, we will lift our eyes.
The Lord who gives joy and strength.
God, those whose joy is morning sun, and those weeping through the night. God, those who tell of battles won, and those struggling in the fight. For his perfect love will never change, and his mercies never. The certain hope of peace.
Oh, rejoice,
rejoice, rejoice. Let every tongue rejoice. One heart, one voice. Oh, Church of Christ, rejoice.
Amen. We testify each week to the truth that binds us together as the Church of God. So young, old, whatever your life today, let us join together around the truth of God's Word.
Come young and old from every land, men and women of the faith. Come those with full or empty hands, find the riches of His grace. Over all to shore, we hear them call. The truth that cries through every age, our God is all in all.
Come on, church.
Rejoice, rejoice, let every tongue rejoice. One heart, one voice, oh, Church of Christ, rejoice.
You'll remain standing as we continue to worship together. This is the gospel that binds us. Paul writes in Philippians 2, in your relationships with one another, have the same mindset as Christ Jesus, who, being in the form, very nature of God, did not consider equality with God to be something to be used to his own advantage. Rather, he made himself nothing. By taking the very nature of a servant, it was this humiliation of Christ that led God to exalt him. Therefore, God exalted him to the highest place, gave him the name above every name, that at the name of Jesus, every knee shall bow. Let us with our praise crown him as King and praise our great God.
The splendor of the King, clothed in majesty, let all the earth rejoice, let all the earth rejoice.
People said, amen. He's worthy. Please be seated. Amen. What a joy it is to worship with you this morning. If you are a guest with us, if you had walked in the building, you would have received one of these worship bulletins. If you're gathering with us in a virtual setting today, you can access this bulletin and a contact card in our church app and on our church website. Those of you in the room, you can also access those in the app. But each week we have guests that worship with us, and what an encouragement that you would join with this family, this church family, on this particular Sunday to worship with us. In your bulletin is one of these welcome to our guest cards. If this is your first time back, or first time in a long time, or maybe you've been worshiping with us for several weeks and you've never filled out one of these cards, we want to ask you to do that. This is all we want to ask of you today, is to fill out as much information as you are willing, and on your way out, place it in one of the offering boxes, either by this door or the one in the lobby. One of the pastors will receive this, and we would love to be able to hear your story and see how we might be able to best minister to you. To those of you who are regular attenders, or maybe you're looking for a way to get involved, in this bulletin are all kinds of updates, some that are really important. One says that our nursery is back and operational. If you have a child who is birthed through pre-K, at any point during this service, if you need to utilize our nursery or preschool area, you can do so by exiting out these doors and follow the blue arrows on the floor. It also shows you that Sunday school started back today. Those of you in the room, raise your hand if you attended a Sunday school class first hour. Amen. What a blessing. Wasn't it good to be back together? So good. If you were not able to make it this morning to a small group class, those are meeting every week at both hours. We'd love to get you connected to one of those classes. And make sure if you don't know which class to gather with, reach out to me or catch our pastor as you're on your way out and let us know you'd like to be involved in one of those. You'll also see dates, families, you'll see dates for children's camp, for youth camp, for our church and community-wide mission project in summer, Love Loud. And one last special thing that I will mention is in just a couple weeks for children's grade 3 through 6, we're going to be gathering on a Saturday morning to join with kiddos from all across the state for a worship event. You'll see that listed in here. This is not just for those in our church, but it's for any in our community. So if you have a 3rd through 6th grader, make note of that. That's going to be going on Saturday, April 24th, and we'd love to worship with them. That's a lot of things. There's more on here following our Facebook page. Just make sure you are informed so you can join with us. As we prepare to continue to worship the Lord in song, will you join me in a word of prayer? Heavenly Father, there are so many things going on in the life of this church, and we praise you for it. We've been robbed, it seems, over the last year and a half, the last year. We've seen thing after program, ministry after ministry seem to come to a grinding halt, and we rejoice today that we are beginning to see the loosening. We're beginning to see the revival of things. Thank you for the opportunity to study your word this morning. May it fill our hearts with your truth that we might respond in praise. This we pray in Jesus' name. Amen. Well, I invite you, church family, join me in standing once again, and let's sing to the King who reigns forevermore. Learned this song over the last few weeks. We sing together to the God who came, the God who lives, and the God who reigns. Let's lift our voices and our hearts together as we sing.
God, the uncreated one, the author of salvation, wrote the laws of space and time, worlds to his design. The one whom angels host revere, hung the stars like chandeliers, numbered every grain of sand, knows the heart of every man. He is King forever. He is King forever.
Our fortress and our strength.
God, our
Good job, worship team. Thank you, choir. Y'all look great up there. Good morning, church family gathered here in our sanctuary, those of you joining us online. What a joy to be back today after Easter and back in our small groups. And so Sunday school, as Pastor Matthew said, has relaunched. It's been a chaotic day. We've had water problems through the building. We've had logistic issues. But this is good. We don't believe in soft launches around here. We believe just going in as full steam ahead and fix it as we go. And that's the way we're doing it today. But the good news is this is such a great day. This is a first time in 13 months, 57 weeks, that we have had Sunday school classes meeting in person on our campus. God be praised for that. And thank you for your flexibility. I know if you're in this 11 o'clock service, you probably were in Sunday school at the more traditional time, but you still came early. We moved it from 9:45, which, let's be honest, most of us were 10, but we pushed it to 9:30. And so we had a little bit more margin, and you came early. You got involved in that class. Thank you for doing that. You're worshiping now. But here's the fun thing. To keep these, you know, the size balanced, there's still room in our sanctuary for people to space appropriately. We have Sunday school classes still meeting now. This is the first time we've been able to maximize our space during both times and use everything all at the same time. We're going to keep trying this. We're going to see how it works and make sure that we've got that flexibility. And so thank you. thank you for trying this with us. Thank you as we will have some growing pains in it and have to fix some things, but we promise you we're going to see God move in mighty ways through this. Let me tell you something else that's really, really amazing that we had the opportunity to do. At 9:30, Lynn and Jessica Parrish were here. Lynn and Jessica Parrish served in our Sunday school program. Lynn is the director, Jessica covering all hospitality needs for almost 2 decades. Our Sunday school program is what it is today because of their tireless effort of working, of serving. If you have served or taught in Sunday school in any capacity, you know how faithful they were and how much effort they put into making it excellent. This past year, because of health concerns in their family and some needs, they decided to step away. And we respect that. We honor that. And we wanted to serve them and let them kind of step into a different role. They're not leaving the church. They're not leaving Sunday school, but they're stepping away from that director role. So this morning, in our 9:30 hour, we were able to honor them for their almost 2 decades of service. You were able, as a church family, to present them a plaque of appreciation to say thank you for your tireless efforts in making our Sunday school what it is today. And your deacons voted unanimously to honor them by making a donation in the name of Lynn and Jessica Parrish to the cancer charity of their choice. And so they're going to be letting us know that you are honoring them today. If you get a chance to see them after this service or sometime this week, tell them how much you appreciate all that they've done in our Sunday school program. And if you didn't, absolutely. And as Matthew said, if you didn't go to a class today, join us next week. We've got classes at both hours. There's flexibility. You'll be able to choose that. All right, this morning, I want to invite you to take this sermon sheet with me. If you're online, you can get this on our app, or if you're in person, you can have a paper copy, or you can get it online. Today, I want to spend a few weeks talking through a series of messages on the family. We're going to call this Building a Healthy Family. The Bible has a lot to say about how we as Christians are to build healthy families. When Emily and I got married, we didn't really give much thought in those early days to what it meant to start a family, to build a family, to be a family. I had, when we first got married, the mindset of the Beatles when it came to a family. I just thought, all you need is love. Boy, was I wrong, right? Anyone who's been around and has started a family and been parents very long knows I've got 3 children and nearly 2 decades of marriage under my belt, and I can tell you, it takes a lot more than love. And the Bible says if you're going to build a healthy family, it takes wisdom. Wisdom is the primary factor it takes to build healthy families. Look at what Proverbs 24 verse 3 says on this sheet. Proverbs 24 verse 3 says, by wisdom a house is built, by understanding it is established. That's true, isn't it? Healthy families don't just happen by accident. Love isn't all you need. Healthy families are the results of wise decisions and wise actions made by wise people. There are some things as an adult, there are some things as a person that you're just going to know intuitively. When you get married, you're going to know some things intuitively. It's just going to be natural to you. When you become a parent, you're going to have instincts and intuitiveness that just help you know how to do certain things. But you don't know everything, do you? None of us know everything. We have to learn, we have to grow, and we have to build a healthy family. It takes wisdom. So this morning, I want us to talk about 4 marks we all need if we're going to have a healthy family. Now listen, notice we're calling it a healthy family. I'm not talking to you in these weeks ahead about a perfect family. There is no such thing as a perfect family. You know why? You're all imperfect people. Imperfect people make up families. So that means there is no perfect family. And I'm not talking about a model family. Listen, you cannot shape your family and decide what it's going to look at based on your favorite television show, based on a reality show that has given you a picture, based on social media and what people will throw up and say, this is what our family looks like. We all know underneath the surface, there is no model family. There aren't perfect families, but you can have a healthy family, a family that experiences the blessings of God. And I want to talk to you about how to do that, because I want us here at First Baptist to be a church filled with healthy families that are showing the world why following Jesus really does make a difference, all the difference in our lives. So how do you build a healthy family? I want you to write down four marks with me this morning. Mark number one of a healthy family: you have to equip your family for life. If you're going to have a healthy family, you've got to equip your family for life. One of the things that will yield health in your family with the people you love is if you are preparing them for the rest of their lives. I don't care if your family is younger than you with kids or grandkids. I don't care if your family is older than you with parents or grandparents or people you love. Your job in a family is to help in whatever capacity you can to equip them for what still lies ahead in their life. The family is designed by God as the training institute for real life. We all learn things in our families that we don't learn anywhere else. And that includes good things, and sometimes it's not so good things, isn't it? We learn all kinds of things in our families. Listen to how the book of Deuteronomy explains to us this equipping that should happen in our families. In chapter 6, verses 6 and 7, it says this: "And these words that I command you today shall be on your heart. You shall teach them diligently to your children, and you shall talk of them when you sit in your house, and when you walk by the way, and when you lie down, and when you rise." It's a holistic picture of this equipping that's to happen from start to finish in your family. Now, I want you to know something. On your sheet right there, when you look at Deuteronomy 6, verse 6, I want you to notice what it says in that second sentence. It says, "You." You. That means these aren't principles that are to be applied to your family by the government. These aren't principles that are to be handled by a preschool. They're not to be handled by a public school. They're not to be handled by a private school. They're not to be handled by a club. It's not even the church's responsibility to apply these principles to your family. These verses are talking to you and to me in our families about how it's to be applied. You have the responsibility to prepare your family, to equip your family for what is to come in life. And notice it says, "You shall." That isn't a request. The word "shall" isn't an option. It's not saying, hey, if you have the time, or if you personally think this is worthwhile, or you have the margin to do it. No, you shall do this. This is an optional for the Christian home. And it says, "You shall teach." Adults, listen to me in this room. Young people, you're just alike in this, but adults especially. Adults are teaching in our lives all the time, whether we know it or not. If there is a child around you in any capacity, you are teaching, and you're teaching things either intentionally or unintentionally. If you don't believe me, just go to Walmart on any given day of the week. You're going to see all kinds of things taught, and most of them are unintentional, aren't they? See, kids watch our moves. That means we're teaching them through our actions, through our example. We're modeling how we think you should live and how they're going to live. The real question is not, are you teaching? The question is, what are you teaching? As we think about the things we should teach, as you think about the example we should be setting to our families, there's a couple of things everybody in this room ought to want to get right. First, you ought to want to get character right. The word character is incredibly important in the equipping process. Character is always shaped in the home. Character are those distinct features of a person that are formed through our choices and through our habits over a lifetime. Your character is who you are based on how you choose to live. As we guide our families, as we pray for them to make good choices in life, they're going to develop strong character if we model it. If our kids don't have good habits, if they don't make good choices, they're not going to have a good character. And it doesn't matter what you say. It doesn't matter how much you try to pry them with your words. Character that is built is near impossible to change. And character is always more caught than it is taught. It has to be modeled through our lives. So character is an important part of equipping, but the second part of equipping is values. Values in our lives. Values are the things that are really important in our lives and the things we devote ourselves to. Values are the things that we put on the top shelf of our priorities in terms of what we're doing and what we want to matter. Whether you realize it or not, the people in your family are picking up values from you. You might be trying to teach them or you might not trying to be teach them, but how you're choosing to live, the things you value are communicating and modeling the values to those in your family. They see what's really important by how you live, not what you say. This is why it's important for every Christian to consider where you're spending your time, how you spend your money, the things you pour yourself into that you show that really matters most. See, our families, our kids, they pick up on what's valuable to us. Your kids are going to develop their value systems about work, their value system about money, their value system about time, their value system about relationships, their value system about sex, their value system about the world, their value system about the future, their value system about politics from you, and they're going to develop where God fits into that value system from you too. Those values are always coming out one way or another. I've heard people say for years as a pastor and as a Christian, I've heard them say, now listen, preacher, I'm not going to impose my beliefs on my kids. I'm not going to be one of those people that imposes my values. I'm going to let them choose for themselves. That's the silliest thing I've ever heard. I don't mean to be rude if you've said that, but don't say it because it's dead wrong. Okay? If we genuinely believe that Christianity is true, if we absolutely are convinced that faith in Jesus is the most valuable value we have to give, then God shouldn't be an option. And let's not allow our kids to make God an option. Let's not, while our kids are in our care and under our homes, let's not let God be an option they can opt in or opt out of. If you don't impose your values, and I'd prefer the word prioritize, but let's just use that word. If you don't impose your values on your family, where are they going to get their values from? You going to let them get their values from the television? You going to let them get their values from school? You going to let their values be shaped by online, by gaming chat groups, by social media? Listen, I don't know if you realize this or not, but right now, in our culture, in our world, there are countless forces trying to impose their values from the outside into your home. You don't have a choice in this matter. Priorities and values are being imposed on your family. The question is, are you going to make the values that matter most the priority? If you think that it's okay to allow other forces to impose their values on your family, but you're not going to make God, you're not going to impose God because that's optional to them, then you are going to end up at the end of this journey feeling like a failure. And I don't want that for you. I want to encourage you this morning to be intentional in equipping your family, whatever children, whatever capacity of family members you have, to instill the values that matter most. And here's what I want to give you an assignment to do. Every person in this room should sit down at some point and make a list of your things that you value. Make a list of your values that are central to your life and ask yourself this question. Am I being intentional in talking about and showing these values to the people that matter to me the most? So don't let this be haphazard. Don't shoot from the hip or play this by ear. Wisdom means you're going to equip your family intentionally for life. That's mark number one. Now, mark number two of a building a healthy family is this. Shield your family in the storms. You want to shield your family in the storms. Now, I want you to notice something on the screen and on your outline. Notice how it's worded. It doesn't say shield your family from storms, does it? It says shield your family in storms. Because you don't have to be a parent. You don't have to be in a family very long to learn that you don't have enough love. You don't have enough power to protect your kids from all the problems that are going to come their way. None of us can. None of us can remove all the storms the people we love are going to face in their lives. None of us can shield the people we love, the children we're trying to invest in, or the people older than us that we love. We cannot shield them from all the ugly that's in the world around us. Those things come no matter what. But we can protect our families. We can shield our families in the midst of storms. You see, life is full of storms, isn't it? We face them all the time. Some of you are in storms right now. Some of us have been in storms that felt like hurricane force winds, don't they? Because they're hard. Storms can leave us battered. They leave us bruised. They beat us down and we feel broken in the aftermath. Life is hard, no matter how young you are, no matter how old you are. And we need to know how to feel safe and secure in those storms. We need to communicate and model how to find peace and protection when life is hard. So how do you do that? Well, as a Christian, the Bible tells all of us that God is our refuge and strength in our hard times. So what that means is in your personal faith, God is your refuge and strength. But listen, God also designated your home, your family, to be a place of refuge as well. Look at what Proverbs says in Proverbs 14, verse 26. It says, in the fear of the Lord, one has strong confidence, and his children will have a refuge. Listen to me there very carefully. The person who honors God with their life, the person who has their confidence built on God and his word, and their faith is rooted in growing in Jesus, has this strong confidence and this place of refuge. But notice, they also are able to provide that to the ones they love. These are words of security. This past year, since last March in this pandemic, we've all been home a lot more than we ever expected to be, haven't we? The pandemic has put us in our homes and outside and not anywhere else for the most part. And this year of a pandemic has resurrected board games, it turns out, more than anyone predicted. Hasbro, for example, reported an immediate surge in their sales once lockdown started hitting. People were getting online and ordering board games to play since they were stuck at home. One executive, as they begin to research this and think about the implications of this surge in sales, one executive for Hasbro said this. He said, board games offer unique benefits that other activities do not because they require presence. They're inherently inclusive. They foster authentic connections across generations. I agree with that completely. That's why my family, we love board games. We did before the pandemic, and the pandemic has strengthened it. Last night, on our Saturday night together, our family played a board game together. We love them. And one of the things about board games, if you play them very much, is some board games, the object of the game is to get home, is to get back to the place of safety, to rejoin the point where you win and you're clear. Because when you're home on that game, you're safe. God has planned that exact same strategy for the homes of Christians. There are a lot of storms that we face, and your home is to be the home base that your family should want to get to. Let me give you some examples of some storms everybody faces in life and how your home can be a refuge in them. The first time a storm everybody faces is storms of change. Boy, we all know that change happens, and it happens a lot. Our world is changing really fast right now. Did you know when I was in college, I didn't have a personal computer. I didn't even know what a personal computer was when I was in college. And now it's unheard of to go away to college unless you have a computer. Today, the culture is changing. Relationships change. Jobs always change. We change where we live. Our health is changing all the time. The storms of change hit all of us, no matter how young or old we are. And the change is sometimes good, and it's sometimes not so good. But listen, change is always stressful when those storms hit. There's also the storm of failure. We need to be aware that if we're going to protect our kids in the storm, there's going to be storms of failure. Nobody wins all the time. Everybody faces failure. Sometimes you're not going to get the job. Sometimes they don't make the team. Sometimes you fail the test. Sometimes there's a relationship where you blow it. Failure comes to all of us, and it hurts. There's storms of change, there's storms of failure, and then there's storms of rejection. And I'm going to just be honest with you this morning. The storm of rejection is really hard, but it's especially hard if you're a teenager, if you're a young adult in any capacity in this room. Because everybody in this room knows what it feels like to be criticized, to be left out, to be pushed away, to not be invited into the cool group or be at the cool table. We've all felt it. Now, everybody handles it differently. And if you're an adult, if you're seasoned in life, you might have a little bit more perspective, and this isn't that hard for you. But listen, It's hard for a lot of people who are struggling in their feelings of who they are and their security, and it's hard for a lot of people. So you might handle it differently. Some people just push through, and some people just don't care. But a lot of people feel the sting really bad in those storms of rejection. And your kids are going to struggle in this. Your grandkids are, and it's important to handle it well. So what do you do for someone you love in those kinds of storms? Let me tell you the best thing, the most obvious thing that you probably already know. You need to pray for them, don't you? But let's not just pray and say prayer is the easy answer. Let's talk specifically about prayer. Listen, one of the greatest doctrines of the Christian faith is the doctrine of God's omnipresence. You know what it means when we say God is omnipresent? It means God is everywhere. There is no place in the universe. There is no place in creation where God's presence cannot and is not be. Okay, so that means God can be everywhere that you're not. So here's practically what that means in your family. I don't know if you know this or not, but you can't go everywhere your children go. You can't protect them from everything they're going to face, but God can. And listen to me very carefully. When you pray and you know that God is omnipresent and you're not, you're acknowledging, God, I'm helpless in this. I can't go where they go. I can't protect them when they're out in life and when these things are going on, but you can. And you're inviting God to work in the lives of the people you love when you can't be there and when you can't fix it. That is why prayer should always be one of the ways we shield them in storms. The second way is you need to listen. You need to listen to the people you love when they're going through storms. A lot of times, we should not be so quick to tell them what we think. A lot of us, when somebody's going through a storm, we're always thinking about what we want to tell them. We want to tell, oh, I've been through that storm before. Let me tell you what I did. Or I want to tell you how to fix this right now. We always want to talk and tell them. When people going through a storm really need somebody to listen to them, to love them. Be a person who listens to them and let them be heard. Hug your kids. Love on them. Tell them that they're special. Cry with them if you have to. And listen to me very carefully. If you're the kind of person who grew up in a really closed-off way, or maybe you didn't have a family that was really expressive with you in terms of affection, and if you're uncomfortable saying things like, I love you, or giving hugs, can I give you a piece of advice? Get over yourself. Just get over yourself. Because give hope when the people you love feel hopeless. Give love when they feel like their world is falling apart. So that's mark number two, okay? Equip your family for life. Number two, shield your family in the storms. Number three, enjoy your family for fun. If you want to build a healthy home, enjoy your family for fun. I know that doesn't sound very biblical, but I promise you, that's a biblical principle. A few years ago, the University of Maryland did a study. They showed through this research that laughter is good for the heart. And when they said heart, they weren't talking about the heart spiritually, they're talking about the heart medically, the physical heart beating in our bodies. They discovered that laughing releases chemicals into the bloodstream. It relaxes the blood vessels. It reduces stress. Laughter reduced blood pressure. Laughter reduced heart rate. It could improve the immune system. The funny thing is, this University of Maryland study told us something the Bible had already told us thousands of years before. Notice what Proverbs 17, verse 22 says. A joyful heart is good medicine. Isn't that striking? The Bible says a joyful heart is good medicine thousands of years before, but a crushed spirit dries up bones. Listen, God intends families to be havens of happiness. God wants your family to be a forum of fun. He wants it to be a center of celebration. The home ought to be a place where it's relaxing. There's an enjoyment, a place where people want to come, they want to stay, and they have fun. In fact, you probably heard the old saying, the family that prays together stays together. I'd add something else to that. The family that plays together stays together as well. The Bible calls us to enjoy our family. Years ago, I read an interview with Max Lucado that just stuck in my brain, and I remember it to this day. Max Lucado is one of the most popular Bible teachers and authors in the Christian world. He's one of my favorites. There's nothing he's written that I haven't enjoyed and found help in. And Max Lucado was talking about his family and how he and his wife raised their kids. And he talked about when his kids became teenagers, he took their basement and converted it into a game room. They put a pool table down there. They put a ping pong table down there. down there. They put foosball, all kinds of games. They pulled out all the stops just to turn this basement into a place of fun for their teenagers. And he said, other dads were making man caves. Other dads were setting up places of private retreat. But he built a teen center in his basement. Here's why. He said he wanted his kids to always be bringing their friends home. He didn't want them trying to leave to go find the fun. He wanted the fun to be right there at home. If you're a parent and you still have the privilege of having kids in your home, I hope you know that is a temporary arrangement. Your kids aren't going to be with you forever. Parenting is a season of life and it passes, so we had better enjoy it while it lasts. Someday, I can tell you the kids are going to be gone. Mine are still in the home, but I remember years ago when I was first a parent and it was really hard, that season when they're toddlers and when they're just in school, they can't do a lot for themselves. You're thinking, boy, I'll be glad when this is over, right? Because you think when your kids are real young, you're thinking, oh man, when they're gone, the dishes will be done finally. I mean, the kitchen won't look like a bomb went off in it. I'm not going to be finding curdled milk and week-old pizza under their beds. I'm going to be cleaning out the trash disposal and finding who knows what that they've thrown down there. I'm going to be able to see out my car window because there's not fingerprints and tongue marks and footprints everywhere in this place, right? I'm not going to hear banging on the bathroom followed by hurry up in there all the time. Someday, it's going to be different. That's what we need to remember. Someday it's going to be different. It'll be calm. It's going to be quiet. And the only thing that's going to fill that space is the memories made of laughter and fun and joy. Can I tell you something? My kids were in the 9:30 service. They're in Sunday school right now. My kids are not impressed by the things that impress adults in my life. My kids are so unimpressed with me and some of the things that adults think, oh, that's great that you did that. Last year, if you recall, I finished my doctoral studies. In this church, you were so kind in honoring me and recognizing me. And I had people come up and say, that's so amazing that you did it. What a milestone. You know what my kids said? My kids said, so you're basically a doctor like Dr. Pepper's a doctor now, huh, Dad? Listen, I'm not kidding when I say this. One of my kids came down and asked me a question. One of my boys, he came down and asked me a question, and then he just stopped and said, wait a minute, I'll go ask Dr. Google instead. This is what I get at home from them, okay? And I'm okay with that because all my kids care about is, are we having fun? Is this a place where they feel safe? Is it an enjoyable place to be in our home? I really want to work on this because I've come to realize my kids aren't going to remember very many sermons I preach to you from this pulpit, but they are going to remember whether or not I was a fun dad or not. So have fun with your family. Model this. Make it a place of enjoyment where they want to come back to even when they don't live there anymore. Those are three principles. Now let me get to the fourth principle because this is the take-home point. This is the one that matters most, okay? Mark number four when you're building a healthy home is point your family to Jesus, because this is the big one. This is the one that we really need to nail down and we really need to get right now more than ever before. Because listen, you might have messed up in some of these other areas. You might have moved beyond the stage of life where you can do some of those other points, and that's okay. It's never too late to nail down this point. It's never too late to be building your family, building a place of love for those who you care about where you're pointing them to Jesus. Listen to what the Bible says in Ephesians chapter 6. It says, fathers, do not provoke your children to anger, but bring them up in the discipline and the instruction of the Lord. God has given the responsibility of spiritual development to parents, and he doesn't make it optional. It's a command. And I want to be very honest with you this morning. If you're a Christian, if you're here in this room and you believe the gospel and you're trusting Christ and you're a member of the local church, here's what I want you to hear, and I hope you hear it in love. It is not the church's responsibility to shape your family spiritually. If you're expecting the church to be the primary operator of spiritual growth in your family, you're going to wake up one day and realize you were dead wrong. Because listen, it's going to take a lot more than an hour, maybe 2 hours a week in a church building to have real spiritual formation that lasts a lifetime for those that you love. See, this is what your, the gospel needs to be a constant presence in your family, to the people you love. Listen, and I get it. I know this is hard because, let's be honest, you don't have all the answers about God and the Bible and faith and Jesus, right? Neither do I, all right? There's no way you could have answers to all the questions your kids are going to ask. When my kids were little, I remember driving down US 23 and being stopped at a red light, and one of my kids in their car seat said, "Dad, who made God? Where'd he come from? You know, how old is he right now?" I'm going to be honest with you. I've been to seminary, and I don't feel equipped to answer that. And they were little. And as they get older, the kids ask harder questions. They ask, why did God make me this way? Why am I struggling in this matter personally when no one else seems to be bothered by this? Why did God allow that person who I love to die? If he's so powerful, if he's so loving, why didn't he do something about it? I'm going to be honest with you. Those questions are hard. I don't care how old you are and how much you studied the Bible. There's no answer that's going to completely satisfy it. I don't have all the answers. My capacity to even pretend I have answers is very limited. But here's what I can always communicate. I can always communicate in my family, I don't know the answers, but I have a heavenly Father who loves me, and he chose to send his Son to die for my sins, and he does have all the answers even when I don't. And it's my job and it's your job to point them to Jesus even when you don't have all the answers. And you can do that. You don't have to be formalized in this. Please don't go home and lecture them and give them an answer sheet with the key. You teach your family better than any sermon I'll preach if you model for them the truths. When you go through storms, your faith is stronger. When you have downtime and when things are going well, you become more generous and you become more faithful and you become more servant-minded. When you live in such a way, you're going to demonstrate the kind of faith your kids want to emulate. I want you to know, we're living in a day where it's just not enough to talk about God anymore. It's not. You have to know God deeply and be walking with Christ personally if you want to point them to him. Because listen, there are a lot of people talking about God right now, and a lot of them aren't Christians. A lot of them do not believe the Bible is God's word, that it has any authority in our lives. They are misrepresentations and mutilations of God. And they're things that Christians don't believe, but they still talk about him. They talk about their higher power. They talk about spiritual forces. They talk about the fact that God is everywhere and God is okay with anything. So talking about God isn't enough anymore. Our kids need to be pointed to Jesus, the Son of God, their Savior who loves them, the one who died for them. We point them towards a Savior, believing and praying that they will personally trust him and surrender to him. God has given you that privilege and responsibility in your family. Our church, the church, comes underneath that to strengthen what you're taking primary responsibility for. See, the bottom line is that a healthy family just doesn't happen by accident. They're intentionally built by wise parents who make wise choices. It begins with a commitment. It means you're going to commit to get your house in order spiritually. You're going to have the right marks in place. However old you are, wherever you might have messed up before, the past is in the past. Don't worry about it. You're at a place right now where no matter who you are, one or more of these marks can help you start rebuilding or building a healthy family. You know, thousands of years ago, Joshua had led the people of Israel into the promised land. They had been told about this for years and years and years, and now it's actualized. They have a nation. They have boundaries. They have land. And Joshua stood before these people as they're excited. They've got their own place now. They're a nation getting ready to just get started in life. And Joshua looked at them and said in chapter 24, verse 15, "Choose this day whom you're going to serve." And he said, whether it's the gods that your fathers worshipped who were idols, these false gods of these other nations, you have to choose for yourself, Joshua said. But as for me and my house, we will serve the Lord. I got news for you this morning. It doesn't matter what anybody else in this church is choosing to worship with their time, with their money, with their resources, with whatever they're doing. Anybody in this community, it doesn't matter what they're choosing to do. That's their choice. They'll answer to God for it. But you can make the commitment to say, as for me and my home, we will serve the Lord. Would you bow your heads with me and pray? I want to talk to you for a second while I need to give our worship team a time to set up, because we're going to sing in a moment. But I want to be very transparent with you this morning, because I recognize some of you, you might be sitting there and feeling, and you might be saying to yourself, I haven't been very wise. And if you feel that way, let me give you some encouragement this morning. Then now is the time for you to get into God's word. That's why this church meets every week, and we go and we study the Bible. We don't talk about principles that are unrelated or life points. We talk about scripture, and we walk you through how this applies to your life. There are Sunday school classes meeting right now that can help you apply this to your life. There are midweek services. There are books and opportunities that we offer to help you develop and build a healthy family and build your faith, so you can be the kind of person that builds a healthy family. It's important. It's the most important job you're ever going to do. I know dads and moms alike too, who spend hours a week working with their kids in Little League, who do travel teams, who teach them how to catch a ball or to hit or to how to shoot a hoop or how to swing a golf club. And that's okay. That's absolutely fine. Keep doing that. But hear me very carefully. If that's all you're doing, by teaching kids how to play sports, you will have done nothing of eternal significance in their lives. You've left them with a hobby that's not going to matter one iota in eternity. What you need to be doing on top of those things is praying with your kids, talking with your family about spiritual issues, dealing head on with problems in a Christian worldview, warning them in advance about the challenges of life they're going to face and how valuable faith in Jesus is to address everything in life the right way. As a dad, my first priority before this church or anything else is that my kids not only know Jesus personally, but they enter his kingdom and know how to address the challenges of life. And friend, listen to me this morning. If you have a child, a grandchild, somebody in your life that you love, and they have not made that decision to follow Christ, you shouldn't let a day go by that you're not praying that they personally come to know Jesus Christ, because their eternal salvation is more important than getting A's. It's more important than them getting a scholarship. It's more important than them getting a scholarship or a star athlete or being popular. You should make that the top priority. So right now, for parents across this room, if you have children or grandchildren, I want to lead you in what I'm calling a parent's prayer, and I would invite you to follow me in praying this over people in your family you love. Pray this way. Dear God, I realize that my kids are a gift from you. I need your help as a parent, a grandparent, a guardian. Help me to prepare them for life. Help me to teach them about right relationships. Help me to model character and values. God, I need your help protecting them when they're in storms. Father, help me to make time for fun with my family. Most of all, Lord, help me point these kids to you for the answers in life. I pray that they would trust Jesus personally. Now, for those of you in this room and you don't have kids in your home, but you love children and you want our church to be filled with children who are hearing about and knowing Jesus, for everyone else, would you pray this prayer? Father, I know there's a lot of kids in this world, kids who need your love, kids who don't have people who care about them. God, today I offer myself to stand in the gap. God, I'll help any child you bring across my path. I open my life to be used by you to make a difference for Jesus. Now, with heads bowed and eyes closed, I'm going to lead you in a prayer in just a second for all of us. But after that, you might still need to make a commitment. You might still need some time with God, whether it's you privately or you want to bring your family. This altar is open and ready. And if you'd like to come and solidify a commitment, dads, if you want to pray with your family, moms, if you want to come and pray holding hands, this is a place where you can come and do something visible and take a step of faith to show your commitment to them and to getting these marks right. And it's going to be open to you. And if you're here this morning personally and there's a decision you need to make, you want to trust Jesus as your Lord and Savior, you're ready to recommit yourself to Him, or I can pray with you, I'll be standing right here at the front with a mask on and a smile ready to meet you. Right after I pray, this is your chance to begin to move and to respond as God leads you. Father, I'm praying for the families in our church, the ones in this space, the ones out in the other parts of the building, the ones watching on television. Thank you for every single person that loves their family this morning and wants to make a difference in it. Give us the wisdom and the patience we need to get this job done that you've called us to do. Help us to do whatever it is you're asking us to do in these moments to make the commitment we need to make. In Jesus' name, amen. I want to invite you to stand. We're going to sing together, and this altar is open for you right now.
Oh, soul, are you weary and troubled? No light in the darkness you see. There's light for a look at the Savior, and life more abundant and free. Turn your eyes upon Jesus. Look full in His wonderful face, and the things of earth will grow strangely dim in the light of His glory and grace. Through death into life everlasting, He passed and we follow Him there. O'er us sin no more hath dominion, for more than conquerors we are. Turn your upon Jesus, look full in His wonderful face, and the things of earth will grow strangely dim in the light of His glory and grace. His word shall in the light of His glory and grace. We continue to sing this morning that God is supreme, that our focus is to serve Him, that we want to live satisfied in Christ Jesus. It's been a good day to be in his house, amen, hasn't it? Let's sing one last song together and rejoice that we are satisfied in Christ alone. This is our prayer, church.
My worth is not in what I own, not in the strength of flesh and bone, but in the costly wounds of love at the cross. My worth is not in skill or name, in win or lose or pride or shame, but in the blood of Christ that flowed at the cross.
Let's thank the Lord.
I rejoice in my Redeemer, greatest treasure, wellspring of my soul. I will trust in him no other. My soul is satisfied in him alone.
Truth sink in, church.
As summer flowers we fade and die, fame, youth, and beauty hurry by, but life eternal calls to us at the cross. I will not boast in wealth or some fleeting light, but I will rejoice in knowing Christ at the cross.
Sing, I rejoice. This last verse, two wonders here that I confess.
Two wonders here that I confess, my worth and my unworthiness, my value fixed, my ransom paid.
This place satisfied in Christ alone. To those of you that have kids in our nursery and preschool, don't forget them. To the rest of you, God bless you. Have a great week.